Thank you
Hi.
very much, Helena. Thank you very much for being available for this short meeting. I don't know, I probably would have to introduce you here to the people seeing this video. Or would you introduce yourself? I mean, we're talking about DSP, we are talking about developmental somatic psychotherapy. You are a senior teacher in that, and we are talking because we are offering a workshop about that in Spain. So
So maybe I should introduce myself or say what this work means for
that would be
me and how
perfect.
come I've started to
Thank
train
you.
in it and teach it. Maybe that's a good idea. Yes, I can start with saying that when I did my Gestalt therapy training and when I came to Gestalt, I felt that the work was mostly attending to the verbal dialogue, and I struggled with that. I was wondering how to include more of movement and more body, and that brought me to study. But I'm not sure if I should bring. Now I'm not talking to you now. I hear that. I'm finding
Okay, maybe we can make this more as a dialogue, or
Yeah.
you're starting to feel that you have to make a monologue.
Yes, and if I need to say something, yeah, and present something, let me
So
know.
maybe you're right. Maybe we can start from did we, both of us, reach or find DSP and how that was useful? How was it for you? You told me sometimes that you were training as a Gestalt therapist. How was that for you?
Well, the training for me, when I started my training, I was also at the time studying a dance and movement approach to, I mean, just a movement approach and called the five rhythms. And doing that practice, I was more experiencing also how we were impacting each other through movement. And that became, I understood that as more of my, a language that felt closer to me than words. But in my training, I felt we were talking a lot, and we were also talking a lot about how to use body in the practice. But when I was with clients, I didn't really know how to do this. How do I bring body into the work? It was so present, of course, all the time, how we are impacting each other and feeling and sensing different rhythms between me and the client. So it's like I knew it was important, but I didn't know how to bring that into practice. How do I work with body and movement? And we had trainers that came to us and had like separate weeks teaching about how to work with body, like an expert that came in, but it became separate. So I was looking for something, how to integrate movement and body into body process into my practice, so that would be there all the time. And that made me to look for different solutions. Like I think many Gestalt therapists do. What do you think? Like look outside sometimes to know, like, so how do I do this? As if we need, of course, being with a client, we also feel we need a structure to know what we're doing. And that's how I found the work of Rolla Frank.
Well, that, for me, that was similar because in my training we were talking about the body, but I didn't feel that I have the sensitivity or the skills to really know what to do. And I was very interested, not because of dance, but because of music. I was very interested in the movements of expression and the tension when I cannot express myself when I'm playing the piano or something like that. So, and I did some, for instance, a little bit of bioenergetics, and I tried to learn about these things. And the feeling was that these body techniques or theories did not fit very well with my Gestalt approach, or the Gestalt approach that I was learning, because they didn't talk about processes, they didn't talk about contacting. So there was also a sense of mismatch that I'm learning interesting things about the body, But then I have to change if I need to use this as a therapist. So there was something that didn't match well.
Yeah. And when I hear you speak now, I'm thinking of that difference really of working with the body. And what you're saying now is more, I hear the rhythms of contacting and coming closer to the undercurrent of experience, how we are being together, and how that is that all the information that is in that. And like now you're nodding as you hear me speak. and that says something. Then I know something about you and me in those small gestures and how we're moving mm-hmm. towards or away from each other, holding my breath, and like you said, being tense when you play the piano.
Mm-hmm. I think that's important to remark here in this context, because maybe people, when they think, okay, this is something about the body in therapy, I guess that in my imagination, at least, I would think about descriptions of body structures and things of that sort that are more related to other approaches, other modalities. And DSP does not have to do with that.
No.
It has to do with the body in movement, as you're saying.
With the stream of contacting that is always happening.
Yes. Yes, exactly. So it's not a description of fixed types. It's more a theory and a practice that helps us be in the process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would say to bring that because that what we're talking about now, that process, that can be very elusive. It's something that is always informing us mm-hmm. to some degree. Something mm-hmm. that is always there. And I think people noticed that also through COVID, when we were separated, we were not being together. All those little informations that we are gathering about the situation. Mm-hmm. And so that knowing, because I call that a knowing, mm-hmm. and that is there all the time. But in DSP, we bring that to the fore. And actually, that is where it comes in, that it's a system where we can learn what it is, more about what it is that we see and feel. Because mm-hmm. I think that this stream of contacting, this process, can be very difficult to grasp. Mm-hmm. It's like a tacit knowing that is there, but difficult to verbalize. Mm-hmm. And when it is, it's also difficult to know what we know. So mm-hmm. in DSP, we then learn, it's a vocabulary, but also a system that can help us to know what is it that I'm feeling in myself? How am I feeling this? And also when I get to recognize it more here and that it is important, then I also see more what's happening for the client and mm-hmm. how we are always impacting each other. How the client's movements has an impact on me and how my movements has an impact on the client. So mm-hmm. those rhythms of contacting that's happening mm-hmm. and that there is a meaning in that.
Yeah, and maybe at this point it will be useful for some people listening to this recording mm-hmm. To explain that, for instance, part of the theory of DSP and what we practice in the training has to do with basic movements. There are six fundamental movements, for instance, mm-hmm. that help us understand, like pushing, yielding in relationship with the environment. That's part of the what the thing is about. When we talk about qualities of movement, we talk about dimensions of movement, we talk about kinesthetic resonance. So mm-hmm.
we talk about movements as dynamics of the field, in a way, of how we are. And then, as you said, it's as if there are, we talk about the action of movement. So the six fundamental movement patterns, that is how we are relating and contacting. Mm-hmm. And looking at the six fundamental movement patterns is also looking at how we develop. So it's development, all of it is developmental movement patterns, but the action of movement and then the quality, so that all the, like you said, all the movements has different qualities, and that the qualities is what's felt. And dimensions, how we shape ourselves and in relation mm-hmm. to others.
Mm. Yeah, because also I think this, I was thinking that this is similar to when if you receive lessons about history of art and someone explains you the different techniques for painting, then if you go to a museum and see a painting, you're not thinking about the theory, but you start to perceive more things. So it attunes your perception. And I think that that's something that happened to me in when I was learning TSP, that it's not that we get a set of exercises. So you are going to make your clients push things or hit things. It's not that kind of thing. It's more, there is a little, some of that as well. But for me, it was more about learning many possibilities and seeing things so that now when I'm with my clients, I feel that I'm more sensitive to their movement, to my movement, and the movements in the field, as you were describing. Mm-hmm. So it's a... So maybe this is what, this brings me to another question. I don't know if I'm interrupting, which is, why do you think it's interesting? How can we explain Gestalt therapists why a TSP training is interesting? How, what will they get out of the training? What
they will get is an expansion of Gestalt therapy, I think. It's looking at how, because we use the word contacting, we use the word experience, but what does that really mean? And how we can break that down even further. Mm-hmm. And look into, I mean, Gestalt is a clinical phenomenological approach, really, and how we can stay more with the experience, mm-hmm. and be more attending to that of the being with as supports for then how we shape the actions and the interventions.
Mm-hmm.
Thing. But it's really looking into, so how, when we say, what is retroflexion, for example? We can have that as a cognitive idea. What is retroflexion? Mm-hmm. But also, how does that live in our bodies? And how is it felt? And how is it living here and now? And what's the function of it? What's the meaning? So we can, together with the client, begin to unpack that and better understand the function and how it's living here. Because mm-hmm. how we move is also how we feel, and how we feel is how we move. So it lives in our posture. And how we, like in small gestures, in micro movements, in how I find and take support in the chair here is also how I find and take support with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what you're saying is that, and I agree with that, is that in a way, all the concepts, or if not all, very many of them, of Gestalt therapy, and of the field theory and the theory of self and retroflexion and introjection and intentionality are in TSP because it's an extension of it, but it's also in a way that we can feel it. So it gives us also a way into this concept that is more sensorial and that we can feel and we can understand these concepts in a different way as well. Like, for instance, the way in which we can be attentive to what we feel as therapists with our clients, it's very much enhanced by learning DSP because you have more elements to feel what you're feeling and make sense of it in the field.
Mm. Mm. The aesthetic criteria that we often talk about in Gestalt.
Yeah, the aesthetic criteria.
And I think then it's important to say something about that in the training program, the focus is to, as you said, of understand how the theory, not just as a concept, but how it lives in me, in my body, so that I know and feel the theory, as to develop the practitioner's feeling and sensing experience, the kinesthetic awareness, and mm-hmm. So that you are more attuned to what you are sensing and feeling when you're with the client. Not that you are feeling what the client is feeling, but that you can bring that into the session more as information and as a knowing about the situation. And using this the system of DSP, the six fundamental movement patterns, the qualities, and the dimension that we study, the system, helps you to better understand the resonance, better get a sense of what is it that I know before I know it. And many of them, when I've been interviewing people who have trained, many talk about that they learn how to think in movement, that they know to better understand the dynamics of how the client is their client is living with them and outside, and also to know that they come into the room with a background, and that background then lives with me, like shaping myself, holding myself tightly like this. Means that I'm feeling something, but I'm also feeling something of what I can and cannot do in the world and with you. So here's my moving story. It's held here and with you.
Yeah.
And as a therapist, I can then pick that up. I mean, I'm feeling something. Not that I should then, and that I think is the difference. Like, it's not that I should then teach my client to move from here to here so that it might be look as if they live more fully life, more to understand what is the function holding myself like this. What's in here? What do I believe about myself? And what do I believe you could do to me, or what would happen to me if I began to open up, or if I held myself in even further? So to understand that moving story that is happening. Which is really that background experiencing how they are contacting the world and how that lives and how they are shaping themselves in relation to, like, the stream of life.
Yeah. I was thinking that sometimes, I mean, we see our clients moving in front of us. And maybe I see that one client is like that, or I see that one client is like that, something that I've seen in, and I react to that as well, but something that I've seen with my supervisees or in myself, but it has changed after learning TSP, is that sometimes you see something in your client's movements and body, but you don't know what to do with that. I've talked with many people about it. It's like, yes, I see movements in the body, but what can I do with that? How do I use that information? How I turn that perception that I'm having into something that I can use proactively in therapy and to generate hypotheses, to generate interventions that make sense. So it's something that I've heard very often. It's like, how I do that?
Yeah.
How do we do that? Yes.
Well, I think that then, like what you're saying, that first of all, to know that there is a meaning in this.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a meaning in this.
And a relational meaning as well.
And a relational meaning. Mm-hmm. And then I can use that either as knowing that that is a relational meaning and I keep it in the background, or I can find ways of bringing that more into the foreground and introduce movement interventions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But the beginning is to notice it, to feel it, and to be able to place that into a context to see that what is the client saying to, what is this has to do with their way of living? What am I saying to you here about me or here?
Or here, yeah. Yes.
And with that as a background, also, of course, we can then bring that in and also use that more as a working directly with that rather than the content, or even to hear movement in the content of what the client is bringing.
Yeah, that's interesting as well, because something that I started to perceive after my training in DSP is that I started to hear movement in the words and in the verbs that. And that's something that in my training that was talked about in my Gestalt therapy training, is like, listen to the verbs. But now had a new meaning after DSP, because now I hear the verbs and the way in which the person selects the words, and I hear the movement. So it's like it has been enriched. In the language has also a movement dimension that I was not aware of before as much. Yeah.
And I mean, I'm just thinking of that right now, in a way, when you and I are having this conversation, because we have different rhythms, you and I.
Yeah.
And and I feel I can feel called to say things, and for me, I sometimes pause and sit back, and not that I mean, noticing how. But I can adjust with you, and you can adjust with me, and that of being flexible in how we are finding ourselves. And I think that's also something that in the training, learning more about your own movement preferences, your own. Your own archives, so to say, where you're coming from and how you are yielding with, pushing against, reaching, grasping, what qualities that you bring with you, or that is your preference, but learning also to be more flexible with that repertoire that can also help you to be with clients, because the more we can expand that movement repertoire, we also expand our moving feeling repertoire and ability to be in contact, which is also what we ultimately want to teach or bring for our clients. So provide that environment from which where they can take support to be who they are, but also incrementally begin to expand that, their ability of being in contact, of knowing that there's a function in this, for example, and how does this serve me? And when does this not serve me? When can I maybe begin to find different ways of accessing support?
And so that's also a personal benefit of this work, is that you can, as a person, I mean, you as a therapist, but also as your personal way of being in the world, we can, it's like adding more possibilities to my ways of moving, my ways of my repertoire, as you said, of movements, and that makes my presence with my clients more richer, in a way.
Knowing, like, and being, I'm thinking of that, and being more aware of what is it, what's happening between me, when do I feel called to move towards the client, for example?
Yeah.
What does this say about me? What's happening here now? Knowing that it has an impact on the client, but what happens for me here? And not that I shouldn't, but then, here I am. Is this because I feel I cannot help you enough? Or what is that I feel that I'm inadequate? So what has just been triggered for me? And can I in that also find back to feel me and be more available to respond to what's happening? Then react.
Yeah. You're repeating a word now that maybe, I think we should not make this very long. So it's time to start finishing. And I think that you're using a word that it makes a lot of sense. It's like feeling. You were saying feel. And here, I think that's what this is about and Gestalt therapy is about. It's like to be more, get deeper into what we feel with the other person, what we feel, and having the feeling guide us through change and through healing.
But also then to trust, because when we say feeling, I think it's important to add that is often labeled as something that's just, you know, something vague and something that isn't part of our intelligence. And where we look at how actually our moving feeling body, our kinesthetic awareness is a root for my psychological function, but also for knowing. That is like how knowing is shaped. So to go to that, how we are gathering information about what's happening, and that is actually can be systemized. It's the way we are. We know, we can find out more. How do we know what we know? Not just, I have an intuition that this is happening. But how do I know that? What is it that I know?
And how is it connected with the situation? And it makes sense as something emerging from the situation. Yeah. It's not just my thing. Yeah. Okay, so do you think it's okay if we stop here?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure to talk to you.
And to you.
And thank you to the listeners for listening. And we are available for in Terapiados Formación, we are available for questions. And please be in touch. Please be in touch or contact us for more information about DSP. Okay. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias. Thank you, Elena.
Thank you, David.